Shut up and sit down.
Do you like power? Do you like hour? Then you love the Power Hour.
Good day and welcome to the Power Hour. We're back. It's Power Hour 20 and it's a special review of the year. We're here to talk about the last 12 months and to review the year that brought you things such as COVID, Carol Baskin, and of course, your beloved Power Hour. So, 2020, how do you think it went?
Yeah, shit. But, I'll just ignore what you said there, Ross. I'm doing great, thanks, mate. Adam, how are you? I couldn't remember what we say.
I am. Well, we're off to a great start. Yeah, I'm fine, lads. Just happy to put this shitty ass year behind us and move on forwards, I suppose. So, yeah, it's good to be back on with yous after the Christmas episode.
He's back. You're back.
I'm back.
Yeah, obviously, it's been a challenging year and a tough year. I saw a comment a few days ago saying it was both a shit show and a train wreck. But however, that is somewhat offensive to shit shows and train wrecks. That's how bad 2020 has been.
Yeah.
I don't know, you know, I've had a marvelous year, if I'm being honest.
I mean, it's not been without, like, it's good moments, but yeah, overall, it's been...
The highlight for me is the fact that you can just sit in your undies all day playing, the PlayStation and not feel guilty.
Yeah. No, not only can you not feel guilty, you can feel like a fucking hero.
And you know what? This is the kind of thing. It's like, you know, a broken clock is right twice a day. You know, a broken Chris is right twice a lifetime. And this is when you're right.
Got one more to go, baby.
Everybody gets two. You might hear in the background there's some loud noises. No, we're not in downtown Baghdad, but the locals are celebrating early. It's 2021. Yeah.
I don't understand. I don't understand getting fireworks anyway, but getting fireworks the day before New Year's Eve.
Yeah, save them. Like, no one's gonna get, oh, you know, there's some good fireworks there. They're all big bangy stuff. It doesn't need to be
Gonna be honest, lads, all fireworks are shite.
Are you gonna fire shoot your work into a fire? Oh, I've got it wrong. are you gonna firework yourself into a fire shoot, brother?
I am. I'm shooting on fireworks.
Enzo Amore shoots hard on fireworks.
No, but like, every time you get fireworks, you get like that box, and then you get like, oh, look at that. There's that big one. That's gonna be sick. That, and then you fire off, and it's always a massive letdown.
Yeah.
What were you expecting, Adam?
Probably, I don't know, like cruise a, ship. You know, like on Lord of the Rings.
Like a Lord of the Rings dragon.
Lord of the Rings when a dragon comes. Yeah. That's what I'm expecting out of that one, but it's not. Never is. And then you got a Catherine wheel that's always stuck on the tree for like 5 years.
Maybe next year we can make our own fireworks.
Well, imminently, of course, is the big pyrotechnic at Monday Night Tuesday. You know, he puts fireworks when people don't even want them, such as myself. So maybe we could speak to him about getting a nice display at the sold-out social distanced waterfront arena.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
So, guys, do you think we should have a song there, maybe?
Well, oh, actually, Chris, I'm going to cut you in there. So, you know, we forgot it last time, and, you know, you reminded me criminally, but I'm ahead of you this time. I'm going to bloody win. It's time for the Flower Hour.
Oh, I actually did forget about this.
Yes, didn't I?
Oh, God. You've really put me under pressure now, because I genuinely can't think of a flower. I'm going to say, you're thinking of a tulip.
Ah, every time. Yes, again, correct, yeah.
I'll send you a 2 pound 50.
I think you were trying to bait him out by not going as obscure this time, and he's out.
I know, game theory was tried there, and it didn't work.
I've been sending him videos of Amsterdam all week, so I think he said tulips.
Bamboozled me. You bamboozled me.
Yeah.
So what am I on now? Is that 4 and out?
We'll do some tallies while we have some music.
The streak.
Absolutely. Eric Clapton, Clapham Common. Hey, Adrian, go clap them alien cheeks, you fat Mark. Moxley. This is Cream with White Room.
Thank you. You said no strings could secure you at the station.
That was Cream with White Room. It's time for the final one of the year, the favourite segment and the listener's favourite segment. It's time for Polly's Pandemic Update.
So, well, it's the Christmas week, and in typical 2020 fashion, I've just bevied every single day.
Oh my god, I wasn't expecting that.
I've let off some absolute humdinger farts. I've eaten shite all week. Played a lot of PlayStation games and had a great time. I've just like tried to sum up the year in 1 week.
Nice. But yeah.
Obviously, with it being Christmas, you know, it's a bit of an odd Christmas time. Very quiet. Yeah. It just, to me, felt like a normal Sunday with a Christmas tree in the corner of the room.
It's been a week. It's been a, I think I speak for everyone here, a month of Sundays the last few days.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it has. I've quite enjoyed it, to be honest. Like I do like between Christmas and New Year, because it's just it's, you know, you can just do whatever you like, really. Just yeah. Sitting here on these.
Yeah, it's that, the
five wanks today.
It's
I'm raw.
It's known widely as the Gooch period, where no one's really sure what's going on or what day it is, but I bloody love it.
The Gooch.
The Gooch.
Absolutely.
The Gooch era.
Yeah, it's.
How about you, boys? Have you found Adam? How's your pandemic update been going?
Well, it's just got a whole lot worse today, didn't it? So, Christmas was good. Because we all got tested before we went, so we could sort of just relax a bit. I went to the testing centre in Liverpool one when I was doing Christmas shopping. Just got it done there. So it was just you could just relax a little bit then and not have to worry about it for once.
Nice, but yeah, it is nice.
But then, yeah, today it's all kicked off again. Back in tier three we go.
So we were the same. We had our COVID tests. Well, I went in the game a few a week or so ago now. So I had my COVID test before then. When the game, one of our friends was there. She, since the game, tested positive for COVID. So I was shit myself before Christmas going for a test. But yeah, luckily came back negative. I had one again since Christmas. Yeah, all fine. So no COVID in our house. But yeah, all in tier three again now as everyone moves up. Apart from the Isle of Scilly, who stays in tier one. So the lucky 2,000 or so in Scilly. You lucky pricks.
The Isle of Scilly.
I've never heard of that. I thought that was very silly. I thought that was it.
They all just tickle each other all night.
You're so silly. We should move there.
We could be kings there.
Or should we, you know, when they all grow up, do they all move to the Isle of Sensible?
When they get to like 21 and get the first job.
So that's what we have, don't tickle me anymore.
Stop tickling me.
You can't be on the Isle of Scilly anymore.
I'm not going to smell your flower. I know it's got water in it.
Yeah. No, I'm not going to look at my shoe.
Yeah, honestly, it's the world record for the most missed handshakes ever. Woo!
I'm not going to open your Christmas present. Last year, there was a boxing glove in it.
Well, I mean, we're all laughing about their name, but ultimately, they gave a pint, and we're not, so...
Needless to say,
they're having the last silly laugh.
The last, the first, the middle... All the silly laughs.
The everything. I can't imagine anything else that's being managed worse than this pandemic by our government. So
imminently, booking of the Christmas night. Not even that.
I don't think.
Well,
I think it, I'd vote for imminently as Prime Minister at this point.
We went all the way to Rio de Janeiro, but didn't go to Rio de Janeiro.
We had a 36 hour flight for a 20 hour flight.
All them delays we had, all them extra in the air for hours.
And then you had Kurt Angle to the mix.
Your odds of landing go way drastically down.
Did you see Mikel Arteta's, I was going to say promo, but his actual interview. Where he said, in a normal Premier League match, you have a 33.5% chance of winning. But against Burnley, it was 12%. And against Liverpool, it was 6%. And then
Impact actually tweeted him.
Yeah. And then you had Kurt Angle to the
sacrifice.
Oh, what a great crossover tweet that is.
Yeah. It's one of those things you never think you'd see.
You never thought would interact.
Mick Arteta and Impact Wrestling in the same tweet.
McKellen Co. down in North London.
Yeah, McKellen Co. down in Tottenham.
In Croydon.
Yeah. But it all, it, I mean, all this also means that there's no no fans at Anfield or Goodison now.
No.
Yeah, I feel sorry for Marine. They were supposed to be playing Tottenham.
I thought you were going to say Mourinho then. I was like, no. Yeah, because that would have been a massive payday for them, wouldn't it?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, that means TV money. But yeah, you're right. They won't have any crowds now, will they? No, they definitely won't. It's a shame for them because, you know, it's a club like that, that could keep them in business for like 10 years or so. That's the kind of money they bring in from that.
Yeah, exactly.
They'll still get the TV money, I suppose.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's still good for them, but yeah, not as good as it could have been.
Yeah. It's one of those things that you could, you know, always laugh at, like, you know, Harry Kane and co. going to Marine.
Yeah.
Well, do you reckon it might have been played at Goodison or Anfield anyway?
Oh, really? Because it's not the ground's not big enough or high quality.
I love that though.
They would have got more fans in.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, but I love that like about the FA Cup. You know, when it's like just a shit, horrible like wooden ground.
Oh yeah, with like people in the literally in the backyard in case of Marine being able to watch over there from the yard into the ground. Yeah, definitely.
The lad that I went to school with, it plays Marine.
Oh, nice.
In the Iblomi, yeah. We went to Ultramarine in the pre-season, and they got beat by Chester, who were only one league above them.
Hang on, Marine got beat by Chester draws.
Well, you know, don't like Marine too much.
They were playing Chester Zoo.
All the monkeys.
Yeah, a giraffe up front, yeah. Heading them in.
It went to penalties, but the monkeys kept hurling shit at the Marine players, and it really put them off. Well, that was the last pandemic update of the year. I'd like to say that would be it now, but unfortunately in 2021, the Power Hour will continue. So yeah. We'll be doing plenty more.
What's going to happen when the pandemic ends, we're all vaccinated, goes life back to normal? What will the segment become? It's Polly's normal life update. So, Polly, what have you been up to? Working.
All right.
So, where should
we have a song
then? Absolutely. ZZ Top, ZZ Middle, ZZ Bottom, Moxley. This is ZZ Top with Tush.
That was ZZ Top with Tush. So, end the year, and we're going to talk about some, the best moments and worst moments from wrestling all around the world. But before then, obviously, can't ignore the death of Brodie Lee, aka Jonathan Hoover. So, obviously, shock to everyone. Mm. No one really saw this coming. Way too young. And by all accounts, the amount of people from the Fed in New York, Marks and George, are an impact. There were people giving him, well wishes and saying how nice a guy he was. He clearly was someone who was well respected and well liked across the entire wrestling world. So a sad loss there.
Yeah,
you know, like I'm. It's weird because like it's really hit me hard this, you know, and it sounds it sounds really weird to think, but like I don't know. It's just I've been probably gutted all week.
Yeah.
Since hearing about it, like I've been proper down. Like I've been obviously going on Reddit and like looking at like night, and people have been putting wrestlers have been putting positive like stories and like making putting a nice spin on it and stuff. But I'm proper just like I don't know. It feels really weird. Like
yeah, I think when I found out, like I was reading it, I was like 1 a.m. and it popped up on like I think it was Twitter account, and I was the Marks and George's Twitter account. Yeah, so it popped up, and then I was reading it, and I was like, hang on, this is an obituary. You know, like, it took me a second to, like, realise that, like, they were saying he was dead. And I was just like, how's that happened? You know what I mean? Like, I didn't remember, like, hearing anything about him being in poor health or anything.
Yeah. Well, Meltzer tweeted or put on Wrestling Observer a few like weeks or months ago that his absence was like a tightly guarded secret and just left it at that.
I think
people were some people were aware that he was in quite a bit of ill health, but people kind of interpreted it as they're saving for a big angle, and that, I think that's why. But ultimately, definitely, obviously, get the guys fighting illness, and unfortunately lost his life. But ultimately, he's allowed his privacy and family time for that. Ultimately, they didn't need to report on it. I think that's where a lot of people don't give Meltz a lot of the respect he deserves, because obviously he would have known. And rather than saying I can break the story, he's had to say actually this goes beyond wrestling journalism.
It's not about business. If he's sick and he's recovering, it's no one's business but his him and his family. So
I think it's just sad the fact that I was a big Luke Harper fan.
Yeah, same.
Especially when he was in his singles run, when he had that Intercontinental match, was it with Ziggler?
Yeah, yeah.
Great match. And then even remember that multi-man ladder match at Mania. And he put Ambrose on the ladder.
Was that Mania
31? I think it might have been
the outside one.
It was the Brian one.
Yeah.
Like, that was that. I really loved his singles run, and I was gutted when he wasn't getting the push.
Mm.
And then he was off telly for probably over a year, wasn't he?
Yeah. And they came back as the Bludgeon Brothers.
And then even after that, they did nothing with him because he had a match at the Mania weekend at Access.
Mm.
Yeah,
and I remember
he was in the Battle Royal with at 34, I think it was.
Yeah,
last time he was seen on in the New York.
I think that's it's the bad thing about being in a faction or a tag team for too long, isn't it?
But the fans liked him. He had a strong following, and then when he signed for Georgia, bloody hell! And then obviously being announced as the Exalted One, I was finally one day. He will be in the main event, world championship picture. It's inevitable. It's gonna happen, and it's just sad that we're not gonna see that now.
Yeah,
yeah. Especially the Dark Order. When they debuted, it wasn't a really great kind of faction. It kind of blew hot and cold. And I think the work they've done with him and BTE really helped. Kind of give an extra depth to them as well. I know you watch a lot of BTI. I don't keep up to track of it, or haven't for a while, but kind of looking at the last episode where they did his best bits, a lot of funny things they did were really good. Throwing papers at people it actually did sound like hurt a bit, but also the fact they sold it like death was really good.
Honestly, BTE has been brilliant this year. I'm going to talk about that a little bit later on, but it's just such a shame, and he was trying to get the other ones over,
Alex Reynolds, John Silver, and all that.
Yeah,
9 and 10.
Yeah, but if you go back and I'd watch if maybe someone will make a just Dark Order segments from the past 5 months or something like that. It's been brilliant, and I thought where this is gonna go, and now obviously with Hangman kind of being, and I was literally waiting for, been thinking for a while. Oh, you know what? Maybe Hangman will join, and then when he comes back, he'll be like either why is he in the group, or there's some sort of angle where it's a standoff between Brodie Lee
and Hangman.
And I thought that payoff would have been brilliant.
Mm.
Yeah, no, great, because I think that'd be really really good, because I think they need to not rehab Hangman, but certainly obviously it needs to be built up to be main event now. I think that's kind of the great kind of redemption arc for his storyline, for his character, but obviously what they're doing now. But not much more we can say about that. It's
massive loss,
yeah,
isn't it?
Loss.
Yeah, but ultimately his family, hope they might.
Yeah, I remember hearing tough period. I think when it finally got to me was the Bray Wyatt little obituary that he did, and when he said we should be wrestling at 70 years old in a high school gym somewhere.
When we're fat, yeah.
Yeah, when we're fat, and it's the Wyatts, and it's that's what it should have been, but unfortunately, this has happened.
Yeah,
yeah. Puts things and it's kind of it's summed this year up, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Of I don't know. You maybe have to think about what's important in your own life, and it's given me a bit of a kick up the arse for the next year. Anyway, I feel like. seeing, you know, making sure what's important. Like, he was a big family man, wasn't he? And about, like, he loved his kids and all that. So I think, I don't know, it's put things into perspective for me, personally.
Yeah, definitely.
And it just seems like he was a really nice person. Out, like, that we never ever got a side to that, because we all saw the scary, big-eyed monster. But, you know, we'll raise a glass to him anyway in the Lizard Lounge.
Yeah, absolutely. But, so yeah, that was our, you know, I say mini tribute, but maybe it elongated. But yeah, we'll move on as best we can and on to the best of the year and some of our favourite bits. So, so for me, I'll start the ball rolling. We've got some awards to give out to some of the category. I know, yeah. So
but no trophies, Ross.
No, imminently.
The golden, what are we
Black
calling
Friday.
It?
What got conned.
What are we calling it?
The golden lees?
The golden
Maybe.
Lee, absolutely.
Absolutely.
So the first golden lee we're going to be giving out is best match. So this is any match that's not Monday Night Tuesday, so from any company around the world. So Marks and Georgia, Fed in New York, Impact, the Gringos in Tijuana, you know, name them, we'll give a award out for it. But for me, match of the year, Hangman and Kenny Omega versus the Young Bucks at Revolution. Not that company. The Marks and Georgia Revolution. Great tag match. Thought it was really, really, really well put together. Good 30-minute storytelling. A lot of great moments through there. And then it kind of really built on the history that they all have together from Bullet Club in Asia, and then obviously the Elite, and then setting up their own company.
Can I shock you?
No.
Okay. Well, guess what? I picked the same match.
Oh no!
Certainly was.
So I think, like, for me, it was the build up. It was everything about it going into it. The fact that Kenny and Hangman, you know, they had a bit of a sour relationship being a tag, but then also the fact that Hangman didn't really want to be in the Elite anymore. He didn't feel part of the Elite, and it just built up perfectly, and the actual match was just amazing. Did you watch that, Adam? Did you ever see that?
I didn't, you know. Like, this is the
you
thing
know what?
With
honestly,
me picking these
go
matches.
Back, cause, well, they still had crowds when this happened.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was the last big, like, event to have crowds, I think.
Honestly, watch it.
Yeah.
Like, even after we do this, I don't think, like, half an hour, whatever.
It's half an hour match, yeah.
It is brilliant.
Okay, yeah.
It was for the tag championship as well.
The what?
It was for the Marks and Georgia Tag Team Championship.
Woo! You know, agree. It was even, you know, I suppose you had to see the video package beforehand to give you a bit of context, but the actual story they told was really, really impressive. Mm. So I think you can watch it as a standalone piece, and it kind of really still scans.
Oh yeah, and the crowd lapped it up. It was I was sitting in bed watching it, like, going crazy.
Yeah.
Like, imagine, like, being in that arena. It was just so good.
Yeah, like, I'll definitely have to give that a watch, because I'm trying to think back. I've probably watched like four matches apart from like Mania. Apart from Mania, like, I've probably watched like a couple. Like, I remember watching Daniel Bryan, AJ Styles for the, I think it was the Intercontinental, on SmackDown.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
While on SmackDown. Back. Yeah, that was a good match.
That was like a 40-minute match, wasn't it? Like, it was quite a long one.
Yeah, yeah. That
maybe not 40, match. But it was long, wasn't it?
The fact that it was quite unique, it being on SmackDown and being a long match, was quite good. And between two amazing workers as well. I really liked Moxley versus Omega. I thought that was really good. Was there any good matches at the beginning of the year, like at Wrestle Kingdom or anything?
So it was NATO versus Okada on night one. Mm.
Was that the double belt one?
Yeah. No, sorry, that's a lie. It was NATO versus, was it Evil? And then
Ibushi,
Okada, Ibushi was the Ooh, night one. And then night two was Okada, NATO for both belts.
That seems like 3 years ago to me,
that's
though.
What I mean. It's like, and like pre-pandemic seems like ages ago. And like, when you're doing Best of Year awards, you don't think of like stuff that happened in early January, do you?
No.
And like, there's probably going to be a really good match. I mean, is Wrestle Kingdom even going ahead? I thought.
Yeah,
it is. Yeah, with a very limited
crowd.
Oh, is it no
very
crowds.
Limited crowd. Yeah.
Yeah, because Moxley was meant to be on that, wasn't he? But he pulled out, I think, because he got injured.
Yeah, because of I think his wife's pregnant. And I think there also obviously there is like the COVID cases. Mm. So I think there's a. I think also Japan are a bit funny about letting people into the country at the moment because of it all. So
oh yeah, that makes sense.
Adam, but you know, I was gonna say Adam, do you know what you said that Kenny Moxley? Yeah. Did you mean that like hardcore match that they had or the title?
The
match?
The title match when with because just as a you know a good storyline match, it was a good match anyway. But like the good what happened after it and all that, I thought that was yeah. That, it's just what wrestling should be.
I really
be about.
Like the. That hardcore match they had, it was that was this year, wasn't it?
That was 2019.
Was it? Yeah.
It was. It was all in or all out.
Okay.
All shake it all
so,
about.
Yeah, it was last year. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. So it's just like you know, trying to think back to what I've watched, but don't know. My match of the year is the Royal Rumble.
Absolutely. Well, that actually links quite well because the next segment is best moment.
Yeah,
and I was thinking, you know, I think it's
don't
been
steal
really
mine.
By not having,
I haven't got many, many
but not having many, you know, not having any fans in, or at least not many, I really hampered kind of the mark out moment. So, my best Fed in New York moment for me, Royal Rumble, Edge returning.
Oh, that was my one, fuck's sake.
We can all agree.
Yeah, that's true.
So yeah, I think the raw emotion after you know after 8 years of him coming back, and you know no one expecting it, and then I think more importantly, seeing how overwhelmed Edge was himself when he kind of you know because obviously you never get the adrenaline rush again from like, the crowd popping for him, and you could see it in like how made up he was and how. How much it meant to him, and then Bucky Beaver, motherfucker, Kevin Dunn ruined the first spear back after his return. So fuck you, Kevin Dunn.
Yeah,
but
do you think they could just re-add it for the network?
Oh, they have.
Oh, have they?
Have.
Oh, good.
But they've,
good.
They cut the first spear out. That's how they re-edited it. Rather than using an alternative camera angle, they just didn't. The first spear didn't happen.
That should be one of our awards. Actually, worst editing moments or Kevin Dunn moments. Like I remember. AJ Styles.
We've only got an hour. There's only so much power we can pack into 1 hour.
The one I'll never forgive is AJ Styles' debut, and they cut to fucking Roman Reigns.
On Roman's theme.
Like,
Roman.
Fuck off.
Yeah.
Like, this is such a big moment. You just fucking screw up by going to stupid Roman Reigns' face.
Whenever Roman's not on screen, the other characters should be saying, "Where's Roman? Where's Roman? What's Roman doing?"
Fuck's sake.
So for my best of the Fed. I had I've got my joint winner and then I put an asterisk down. So my asterisk was Edge Royal Rumble, and it was
nearly a clean sweep for Edge.
It was also I also put as an asterisk Drew winning at Mania.
Yeah. So it's such a good moment, but it's just ruined by the lack of crowds, isn't it?
No crowds.
But
yeah.
I think in a way I enjoyed it because you heard Heyman screaming at Brock.
Yeah. Yeah,
like,
that's a match. Yeah.
That wouldn't have got picked up on if there was in a big stadium.
You say that,
but
like
went,
when the streak ended, you could hear him go, "Oh my god," you know, all that stuff.
Yeah, true.
So you got
but there, I think yeah. like because he was quite vocal throughout. I mean, I don't think they would have heard everything, but I couldn't really pick one. But I went down the cinematic route. So my moments of the Firefly Funhouse match and the Boneyard match were my favourite.
Yeah, they were great.
Fed New York moments of this year.
Yeah.
I think that
two
that
very
top,
different
the
things.
Top Mania that made Mania for me.
Yeah,
and we talked about it a lot on an early Power Hour, but especially that was the last that we'll see Undertaker in a match.
Yeah, and it was a good match. It was a good ending point.
Yeah,
even though there's not definitely. A crowd for him to say, he already said goodbye. So you know when he put his hat in the ring and all that.
Yeah,
like he already said goodbye properly. So this is just you know icing on the cake, isn't it?
Yeah, and I do think that the Firefly Funhouse match was really good. I'm fair play to Cena for putting over Bray so well.
Absolutely, yeah, definitely.
Any more awards?
So should we all just agree on Edge?
Yeah, I think
that
Edge was
well done. Edge, the Golden Lee is on its way. No, imminent Lee, you've sent it to Edge from you too.
No.
I was going to do a really shitty Irish accent then.
This is going to go to his head.
The edge is fine.
And how's Adam Clayton?
What's in your little hat today?
He's playing a gig. He just takes the beanie off and there's a gold Lee on me. Back!
It's me, golden Lee.
This is all for Rooney to edit a golden statue onto the Edge's head.
Yeah. New task for
are
you.
Are we even going to give him the thumbnail suggestion? Yeah,
absolutely. I think that is the thumbnail now.
Happy New Year, Jordan. Enjoy adding that.
Thanks, lads. So, moving on to the best Marks in Georgia moments. I've got a funny feeling Polly will be the same with me. But from our match of the year, Kenny Omega kicking out of the Golden Trigger at one. For me, ooh, best moments of the entire year. The crowd went fucking batshit crazy. Kenny broke his hand as part of the after kind of hulking up. Just fantastic storytelling. Obviously, you might need to a bit more background of, you know, the move itself and how Ibushi and Omega had beat the Bucks with the same move in Japan. But then the Bucks do it, and then Kenny has, you know, completely incandescent about being hit with their move, kicks out at one, goes batshit crazy, crowd go mad, everybody makes money, lovely stuff.
I really got to watch this match.
I lost it when that happened. I mean, like for me, if I'd probably remembered that, I probably would have picked it, to be honest. So I did my asterisk for this one. I just put Dark Order on BTE. Like, it's been really good, like, to see them go from a bit of a lame heel group to showing how goofy and stupid they are and the potential that the members have going forward. Where, like, if the, I mean, I don't watch Dark, whether they're on it or not, I don't watch it, so I don't, I'll never see them like progressing. But
I think 9 and 10 on it. I think the lower of the lower orders of the Dark Order on it.
I mean, it's been really good development, so I've really enjoyed that. But my one, I put Kenny winning the belt for mine. Because the shock value of the whole Don Callis side of it and the impact.
Yeah, I agree.
And the thing with Impact, that no one saw that coming and people were talking about that. And people have been watching Impact now.
Yeah.
So that was wrestling's like, hot from it. Like,
yeah, so really, that is, it's reignited people's like interest. I mean, there might be people who you know, stopped watching the Fed and watched TNA back in the day. And now they see Impact trending on Twitter going, what's this?
Yeah.
Like, everyone was talking about it. So I went with Kenny winning the belt.
Well, Chris, you've stolen my answer again, because that was my one, because it was one of the only moments I watched. But yeah, it was really good, just, you know, like, leaving everyone in suspense and getting people to watch Impact and all that. So yeah, it was great. So yeah, that was my one again.
So Kenny Omega, do you win it? I mean, like, not for the same moment, but Kenny Omega wins the next Golden League.
Yeah.
Well done, Kenny Omega, absolutely. So well done, Kenny Omega. Omega Man, expect a Golden League coming to you from imminently anytime soon. Wrapping this up, for me, worst part of the year. It's not solely to one company, and certainly everyone's been affected by it. It's having, apart from, of course, Monday Night Tuesday, who have a sold out following.
Yeah.
No fans.
It is.
Got no fans.
All limited fans.
Got no grand.
It's just really tough. Looking back at, you know, the favorite moment I had of the year with Omega, you know, kicking out at one and crowd going mental. It just adds so much to a match.
Yeah.
I think you realize, we love the cinematic matches and they have their place, but the seeing crowd reactions, that's what makes it. I think you do need to have it.
I mean, as good as the cinematic matches were, it still seems awkward, doesn't it? Just having loads of, like, dead air. And just the...
What do you mean? We have the Thunderdome!
it's one of those things, like, it really does... The crowd really does add to a match. And to be fair, that's why Meltzer does have, you know, crowd... how into a match they are when he does his five-star ratings.
Yeah.
And I think this year's shown why it's so important to have a crowd that's hot for a match. Because it really does, you know, elevate things, you know... I don't know about you guys, one of my favourite matches of all time is Rock Hogan at WrestleMania 18.
It's not like an amazing match, but yeah. It's just
very poor, it's a very basic wrestling match, but because the crowd are so into it and so hot for it, it's unbelievable match, because it just means so much.
When Hulk starts hulking up.
Oh my god, when he blocks the last bunch of points at him. Shit. Like, Jesus Christ, the crowd's going fucking mad. Amazing.
Yeah, and that makes it, you know, one of the all-time great matches because of the crowd. You know, ultimately, the match itself.
I mean, it doesn't even make sense from a storytelling perspective. Like, Hulk Hogan was meant to be the heel, and everyone's going for the mad for him.
They had to change, didn't they, mid-match?
Yeah, exactly, and that's just like, you can't write that kind of thing. It just happens, doesn't it?
I think having the crowd, I think, really does take a lot away from wrestling. But hopefully, you know, we've got the vaccine coming. at least if you live in a first world country. So yay us.
Yay.
We'll be able to go to watch matches soon. But of course, Monday night, Tuesday, still sold out and still socially distanced and still a full Waterfront Arena.
Take that, fellow New York.
Exactly. Stick your Thunder Dome up your ass.
Mm-hmm.
So my one for this, now that I've wrote it down, I didn't research it. And I'm thinking, before I said a match and you went up laughing last year, I'm hoping this happens in 2020. Whether, even if it didn't, I'm sticking to me guns and it'll lose 2 years in a row. Because my worst wrestler moment was Hell in a Cell, Seth Rollins versus The Fiend. Please tell me that was 2020.
2019.
It wins it 2 years in a row.
It was that bad.
Fucking hell.
So, should we all agree that the winner of the Golden Lee Award is Kevin Dunn?
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely.
But to be fair, if I had to go for one for this year that was actually wrestling-related, and my asterisk pick would be the Sammy Guevara-Matt Hardy street fight match carrying on, despite Matt Hardy clearly being unconscious.
Yeah.
You know, we give a lot of shit out to the Fed in New York, for stuff like that, that's but ultimately bad. That's fully on TK. That match should have been stopped.
Yeah, absolutely. Throw the axes off.
Busted right open. He didn't know where he was. Guevara had to carry him through the match. Awful. And then, of course, my final asterisk, for wrestling in general, anyone who was part of the allegations of grooming and sexual assault of women,
fuck all of those guys.
Fuck all of you, particularly Wolfgang, you're a piece of shit.
Yep.
I should laugh on that bit. Yeah. I knew Wolf, as soon as she said it, I was like, we're going hard on Wolfgang. Yeah. You fat, horrible jock prick.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, likes of David Starr and Joey Ryan et al. Not a stain in wrestling that wasn't needed.
Yep.
Agreed.
Right. Should we have a...
We'll come back with some more Golden Lees, but first let's have some music for a nice little break.
Ruben Neves, Ruben Sandwich, Ruben, ah, Moxley. This is Let's Stop Hanging Out by Ruben.
Of all the things that you do best, disaster makes you happiest. Some burn the clothes that you want in, and a stink of smoke and sweat and skin. You cry because I'm so calm inside. You scream yourself, I run, I hide. Still, we have no answer to the question, what do we do? Oh, let's stop hanging out, let's stop having fun. We'll be right back.
stop hanging out by Ruben. So we're going to carry on with the Golden Lees, and we're going to have a chat about the best MNT match of the year. So obviously it's a fledgling company, and if it wasn't for the bubble bursting and bursting and bursting again, we would have had our first pay-per-view, but that's coming up in New Year, New Me. Can't wait for that one. So we've got a few TV matches to go through, but I'm actually going for none of the TV matches. I'm going to go for the Rio, Wisconsin Power Hour match. Rabbi versus basically for my match of the year for Monday Night Tuesday. What a barn burner.
That's a good choice. That is a really good choice, because it was, I mean, it's just such a shame we didn't film it, but like for those in attendance, which is just us three and the announcer, Howard Finkel's son, it was a barn burner, if you don't mind the pun.
Absolutely. Yeah, great.
That was my was my asterisk.
Yeah, so I mean, my asterisk for this one was if we had to pick a match that actually happened in person, I would say for the sheer shock and drama, the Miracle on the Waterfront Arena, Daniel Druff.
That was my one.
What a match! And you know, maybe a bit of bias because Stan, of course, was in it, but for me, match of the year. Second to Rabbi.
I was going to go for that one actually.
That was amazing, that one. That was my second pick. I actually picked Misunderstood versus Superb for my match of the year.
Good match.
And I think that, you know,
well,
not only was it a good match, then cameraman Steve was on point for that
certainly
match
was
as well. So that was mine. I've got to big up the women. I'm a big believer in I think you'll notice on previous Power Hours I try to pick not today, but normally I like to pick female artists. And try and even up a little bit. So, I'm a big believer in our women's division. It's only going to get stronger over the next year, really.
Absolutely.
You know, we haven't really debuted that many women yet, but I'd say for me it was Misunderstood versus Superb.
Nice. I was going to go with my one would be the Miracle on the Waterfront, just for the sheer shock value of it. Just like, I don't think anyone expected that. I thought we all thought Lunchador was going to win, or Stan. But, you know, it came down to the last two. Daniel Druff didn't do anything in the whole match, and then, you know, just moves out the way. And, he won. And it was an incredible moment for all
Absolutely.
The MNT Cosmos.
Absolutely. And he's not stopped since as well. He's still going on about it. So,
certainly
of course, he's in that final, the Fatal 4-Way. So, we'll see.
Yeah, we'll have to get him on the Power Hour, so, you know, see what he thinks about it.
Socially
his
distanced, of course, preferably in a separate room.
I think what my asterisk would be... I think I had one before. I'm going to go for the triple threat with Muhammad Mentum, the Rabbi, and Mikey Shawnels.
Oh, good
yes.
Match. I think it had a little bit of everything. We had Muhammad Mentum high flying moves, you know, couldn't be stopped at the start. You know, we had Mikey Shawnels, you know, just missing the Sour Jaw tunes. I think that could have been a big moment. And then obviously we had the circumcision, you know, born again Christian to born again Jew.
What a match.
And then, you know, yeah, the Rabbi picking up the win with the dreidel. So, yeah, it had a little bit of everything in that match. So, yeah, that'll be my asterisk.
I think with, like, what we've got planned for next year, and obviously having, like, pay-per-view after pay-per-view, you know, we're going to get the ball rolling in the next 2020. I think next year is going to be a lot harder to pick. But I think what we have chosen are great matches so far, and I think it's only going to get better.
Absolutely.
So, I think, yeah, I will agree. It was an asterisk for me, so... Unfortunately, I think Daniel Druff is the winner of Golden Lee.
That's unfortunate, but yeah, we credit where credit's due.
Absolutely. So well done, Daniel Druff. So best face from around the world, besides Chris's face, of course.
Oh, you.
Is we're going to go, or for me...
Take that, Adam.
No.
I'm going to go...
The silver face.
For John Moxley. For he's been really good. His promos have been killer. He's held the belt like a champion, because he is the champion. Mm. But locally, he's also been holding it like he is a champion. But I think more importantly, he's one of the few people who has actually in you know, the modern era been able to be a face but also cool and likable, rather than you know, the kind of the Cena or old Roman, the cookie cutter kind of role. I think he's been a lot of sides to him, but I think ultimately he's really well liked. I think he's a fantastic babyface.
I think that's what you can do in the Marks and Georgia as well, that you can't really do in the Fed, because like it seems like every face, we all know every face is picked by Vince and we usually don't agree with it. So it's to be a genuine face where everyone likes you is really difficult in the Fed, I think.
Absolutely.
Do you want to go next, Chris?
Well, yeah, I mean, for both of mine, even for like our next award, like for the heel and the face, I always like a bit of a tweener. I like someone who can... Well, right, before I get into that, I'll tell you who my asterisk was: Hangman Adam Page.
Yeah.
For the cowboy shit, when he was just drinking all the time, and I was going to go for him, but I like a tweener. I like someone who can be portrayed as maybe a heel, but the crowd like, so he's a face. So
like Austin, you mean? Like
yeah, like for mine, it does really link into a bit of last year as well.
classic Chris Golden Lee territory. Based on what they did last year, my face of the year.
It takes me a year to like them. I've gone with Bray Wyatt.
Because the
Fiend does go into that as well. But I think his work in this year and last year has been phenomenal. Like the Firefly Funhouse stuff, and just the fact that he's had more wrestler matches this year as Bray. And I don't know, I just went with Bray. I thought he deserves it. He deserves an award.
Yeah, well, he deserved to get a push for 6 odd years, you know what I mean? He no matter how much we like him and how much we want him to do better, like he just keeps getting buried. So it's about time, you know. He's got a really good gimmick and it's really over. So yeah, good for him.
Yeah. How about you, Adam?
So comes from the fact that I haven't watched much wrestling this year. As I say all the time.
Daniel Druff?
It's Daniel Druff. No, I'm going to go best face. I'm going to go with Drew McIntyre.
Yeah, nice
job. I really like him, and I've always really... Like, I liked him because we used to go to, like, shows when they used to tour. Back when it was, like, Grado and Jack Jester and all that. But, like, Drew, you know, coming from the... He didn't make it the first time.
I think Adam, I think you mean the jocks in Edinburgh, and I think you mean the Fed in New York.
Oh yeah, certainly do. We'll bleep those. And it was just nice. It's unfortunate it wasn't in front of a crowd, but it was just nice to see, you know, a lad from the UK, from a part of the UK we actually like, being Glasgow.
Very similar town to us, isn't it?
Yeah, we get on with Glaswegians, so it was nice to see one of them get over and after, you know, second attempt.
I felt very proud when he won it, and I have nothing to do with his progression or his life, but I was like,
thanks, Chris.
It was like a good, like, wholesome feel.
Yeah, it was a good,
like,
wholesome feel.
Go on, lad.
Yeah, and also it's like, it was really believable in beating Lesnar, because he's taller than Lesnar. He's just, you know, he's not as big, but he's it's very believable that he'd win the belt off Lesnar. So it didn't seem like a mad shock.
We were very lucky in, like, the sense that when we saw him at the Jocks in Edinburgh, that was his kind of, like, he had a bit of time off and he got bigger. Like, he looked scarier, he looked meaner. We saw the start of that, like, redemption story.
So the moral of the story is, if you want to get over, just get more beef.
stop shaving your chest, grow a beard.
Yeah, he's one for the mums, isn't he? He's like something out of a romance novel or something.
Speak for your own mum, Adam.
I will. Shout out to the Andrea community.
The
Andrea community.
All right.
Are we done? Are you doing best heel?
No, who's winning it? Who's winning the Lee?
Ooh, who are we going for?
Who did you say again?
I said Moxley. You said Fiend, Bray Wyatt.
I said Drew.
Adam said Drew.
I would go with, personally, I'll go with Drew.
You know what? Mm. Actually, I'm going to make a ruling. It's Oil. Oil wins Golden Lee. Yes. He's my favourite.
I mean, I love him.
He's everyone's favourite.
You love him. Everyone loves him. Oil.
Oil.
Oil. So I think
okay, Oil wins.
Oil is so over, to be fair.
So on to best heel. So this is actually the one that I've got. I've got 3 asterisks as four, and an actual winner. So my 3 asterisks. So firstly, Bailey. So from someone who was kind of that such a genuine babyface character, and they dropped the ball on them for so many years on the main roster. To go and be the heel, the soccer mum heel she's been, has been fantastic. She's been a focal point of the show for all year, really, as champion, and then the year as team captain for SmackDown. I thought she's been fantastic, and a really good change of character, and really good change of pace. I really enjoyed the story they did with Sasha Banks.
I agree. She's been considering that she got a bit stale as the hugger, and I loved her. I loved her with Paul and Co. Yeah. But then crowds weren't. They just weren't getting into it. And she seemed nervous, and she didn't really know what she wanted to be. She didn't know what she wanted to be, and I think that the fact that there hasn't been crowds has given her the opportunity to be a bit more confident. It's given her a bit of a push.
Yeah.
And I'm glad now that when the crowds do come back, she's gonna go for it. And I feel a bit proud of her.
Thanks, Chris.
I'm gonna make teary eyes.
Oh, look, it's your dog.
I want to just dedicate this title to...
She's Bailey's dog.
She's probably older than me.
Yeah, I want to dedicate this title to Chris for always believing in me.
There ain't no stopping us now.
So, my second asterisk, he's been on fire this year, Orton. Fantastic as the legend killer punting everyone that moves. And then the bell running now, obviously, the literal murder of Fiend and presumably of Alexa Bliss as well. Fantastic. Yep. He's been really good.
I'm still bored of him.
Same, I am as well.
I think he's been good.
I think I'll always be bored of him.
I think he's done a lot of good work, I think.
For me, Orton is just copying the superstar.
Well, Orton, of course, got the he's at the apex of the superstar's reign. That's why he's the apex predator. So he's obviously all got, he's got the XP, he's got all the movesets, he's got the tattoos. He's got the taunts.
Yeah.
He's got the entrance. So he's what Superstar wants to be in like 5 years time. And then my final asterisk before I get to my actual pick was the steward for Paul and his British chams in Slough when we went to watch their show in York, Chris, who kept kicking off when we stood up, put our beer on the balcony. So he's the biggest heel of the year. Only to one person. The winner of biggest heel for me. Roman Reigns as the tribal chief.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
That's mine as well.
Knocked it out of the park. He has been unbelievable in that role. We've said it for, you know, a lot of people have said it for years that he should be a heel. No one could really imagine how good he actually would be because he's actually is dislikable. He steers right into it and looks like and comes across as a piece of shit. Brilliant. Especially Adam Heyman's really good at it.
Again, I will say, like, it takes the shine off it because we've been asking for years, and I think there was a point about 2 years ago where it would have been white hot, like, the fact that, you know, everyone hated him, and, like, you know, when he was getting booed constantly, and, like, after the leukemia thing, you did warm to him as a face a little bit, but, so, I think it would have been better to have pulled the trigger years ago, but like it's good that they finally done it, and yeah, it does work. It just works.
I still feel like the trigger point for it would have been he cheats to beat Taker at Mania. Would have been the
exactly,
obviously
yeah.
they didn't run with
oh,
it.
Oh yeah.
But ultimately, how good he's being at it now. He you know, there was always glimpses, you know, eliminating Taker from the Rumble, beating him, and then the 10 minutes of getting booed at the post Mania show, Raw. He's been brilliant, and I think he'll thrive when the crowds come back and he can really kind of lap it up.
Yeah, that's the shame, isn't it?
It's weird to think, though, that like, it wouldn't have mattered the situation that he had them championships, but if he was a heel, we would have liked him.
But it would have made
so much sense. Like, he could have done the same fucking promo that he did after Taker, where he stood in the ring, he accepted the booze, and said, "That's my yard now." And it would have worked. Yeah. 10 times better if he was already a heel.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense as a fucking face.
No
promo.
One liked him when he's doing them stupid Vince promos.
It doesn't make sense.
Yeah,
he looks more comfortable doing the heel promos, but he actually is dislikable because he comes across as a bully.
He was a heel. Really, he was a heel in FC when he first joined in FC.
Who?
He was I'll bleep it. I'm talking about Paul and Cow.
I'll bleep it.
Damn it.
God, just bleep. Blaper Damon.
But like, he was a heel. His character was like, my family are in the wrestling business. I'm like, I'm gonna make it and all this. And it worked then. So why did they turn him into a too much of a babyface?
Absolutely.
They tried to mold him into Cena before he did anything worthwhile.
Exactly.
And people got sick of it straight away. Do you remember the remember the Rumble that he won? And everyone was just like, this is the most stupid.
You know what? Like when I think we were at Camp of Furnace watching it. And then we were like, oh, he's going to be number 30. It's going to be, it's going to be this person or what? And then it was Roman Reigns. And I literally just fucking walked the bug. And I was just like, I'm done with this company.
Done.
I was literally like, I'm done with this company. It's so stupid. Like, how they thought, like, people were going to go, oh my God, yes, it's Roman Reigns. Yeah.
And, I will agree with you on that one. I mean, my asterisk was Roman. But I love a tweener, and I love someone who can work as a heel, but is a face, and vice versa. I went for MJF.
Oh, good show!
Oh yeah, brilliant!
Yeah,
brilliant.
I just think from the get go, yet again, previous year. But I think everything that he's done is gold, and I think he knows how to react. If someone throws him off of something that he is not expecting, he's got a comeback. When he meets fans and he does charity events, he agrees to do charity events, like help people. He's a dickhead to people when he's there.
Yeah, I love that. Stays in character all the time.
He lives that character. So I was going to go with MJF, but I will have to agree with you boys that Roman has finally, it's the character that we all wanted him to be.
Yeah. Well, I've got a curveball to throw at you guys then.
Ooh.
In this case, because seeing as how I had Roman as well,
Ross,
I'm gonna go.
Ross is my heel.
Ross, I hate you, Ross.
Yeah.
No, but it does relate to Ross because he's only a heel to one person. It's Orange Cassidy.
Oh,
absolutely.
Everyone loves him, but Ross.
He's not a heel.
I know, but everyone loves him, but Ross.
So is Ross actually your heel of the year?
Yeah.
Right, I'm voting Ross.
No, actually,
you voting for Adam?
I'm voting Ross.
Right,
expect your Lee in the post.
I was going to make a really good joke about imminent Lee sending the Golden Lee to the Roman Empire, but fair enough.
Okay. I'm going to change my mind and go with the Chunky Monkey.
Dastardly.
Yeah.
Dastardly heel.
Dastardly man. Or monkey. Ooh.
We'll find out soon.
Is he man or is he monkey?
Where does a monkey start and the man begin?
You're just a chunky man.
Chunky
he takes his mask off. It's the chunky man.
Chunky man.
Pull his mask off.
He's a man.
Peel his banana. Right, well, that about covers it off. So that's all the wrestling awards done. So we'll have a bit of culture in a bit, but carrying on that culture theme, some music.
No More Nails, Hard As Nails, The Wrestler Nails, Moxley. This is Nine Inch Nails with The Good Soldier.
Number one.
That was Nine Inch Nails with The Good Soldier. So we're going to have a bit of culture now. So we've talked about all things wrestling. So we're going to talk about some music and some TV and some film. So first one, best song of 2020. So we were talking in the ad break amongst ourselves, saying, you know, it's been a bit of a weird year for music. Mm-hmm. With, you know,
were we?
Obviously, me and Adam were. You were having another shit.
I like to just state I wasn't shitting.
Well,
wouldn't have
smoking,
made
shitting,
quick.
Whatever.
3 minutes. 3 minutes for a shit.
It's two against one.
Yeah, that's all I heard. But it's been a weird year for music. So obviously, it's been you know, everyone's been a bit thrown out. So albums have come out kind of recorded in different ways, etc. But for me, best song of the year, Tame Impala, Breathe Deeper.
Nice
really
choice,
good album,
yeah. Good choice.
And you know, really love everything they do. I do love the way that they kind of seemingly reinvent themselves every album. And really, for me,
you know,
no different this year.
You know what blew my mind that I learnt this year about Tame Impala? You say we, but Tame Impala's actually just one guy.
He, yeah, yeah,
yeah. And I was like, I didn't realise that, but apparently it was just because it's easier to market a band than it is to market.
Yeah, it's Kevin Parker, isn't it?
Yeah, it's just Kevin Parker by himself. Yeah, but...
And he plays bloody every instrument himself. No, yeah. I'm joking. No, it's what's the same. As a big artist, it's, for me, song of the year. But yeah, I think you're right. I've not, unfortunately, actually been able to see them live.
I saw them, like,
with his backing
2 years
band.
Ago. They are amazing.
Ross, guess what, Ross?
You have?
I've seen them about 6 times.
Yeah.
Well,
we saw them at Glastonbury as well, didn't we? Yeah.
Did you see them in 2020? No, you didn't. So fuck off.
For mine, which is quite, it's been a bizarre year that, like, I didn't like that Tame Impala album that much. Mm. And normally I would go for like a pretentious album, not meaning to be pretentious, but I just would, like, it would be some album that, like, or a song.
Songs
that, like, I don't know, maybe something. But I've not heard much music that I've been into, so I've gone mainstream as fuck for mine. So my asterisk was Blinded by the Lights by The Weeknd.
Yes,
yeah,
same,
I was thinking that
same.
One as well, actually, yeah.
That was very close to be my
it
number
was.
One.
Because when it first came out, it was a bit like because it was like a TikTok song and a WrestleMania song, apparently. But yeah,
and a Ross TikTok video with his beard, and he got me
exactly.
to do it.
Most famously.
Absolutely.
He's like that. She's like got a gun to his head. Now he's going absolutely.
I love TikTok.
But my main song that I went for is Midnight Sky by Miley Cyrus.
Oh yeah, yeah. You know what? Like I saw Miley Cyrus do a cover of Zombie by the Cranberries at the Whiskey. I think it was Whiskey A Go Go because they had like a mini festival to say
in
venues.
Person.
Yeah, it was like. No, I don't
know.
No.
Oh.
A Whiskey Go Go in LA during the pandemic.
I was going to say.
No, it was like a mini festival on YouTube. I think like the Foo Fighters played and a couple of other bands, but like she did the cover of Zombie and it was amazing.
She does a great cover of Heart of Glass by Blondie as well.
Yeah. She's done loads of good, really good covers. She did Jolene really well. Like
She should make like more rocky stuff. Like she's
yeah,
got
she does.
Belt a set of pipes on her.
Yeah. She was on Rogan though, and she sounded fucking terrible.
She also does a really good cover of Hannah Montana. She does a really good cover of Hannah Montana songs as well.
Yeah,
I wouldn't know that, Ross, because I won't say why. I want people to listen to this. Yeah, they're mine.
Yeah, so song of the year for me, I'm gonna be proper lame, and I'm gonna go for Meal Deal by Craig.
Oh, I was gonna do that for mine, yeah.
Yeah, so like for anyone who doesn't know, our mate Craig got signed this year. Was it? It was this year, wasn't it? Yeah,
to City Slang Records.
Yeah, so he's up there with like Caribou and Now the Surf and a couple of other bands, Tindersticks.
They had Arcade Fire on the books.
So he's been. It's a big label, you know, and he's done. Him and Hannah have done really well to get signed. So. And yeah, it is a great tune as well. If you want to check it out, Meal Deal by King Hannah.
And you will also, you'll be hearing it very, because we've had the rights off Craig.
Yeah.
I can upload the picture of the text to prove that we can play it. It will be on a promo for our pay-per-view. We'll We won't say anything more because there's stuff coming that you haven't seen yet. But there is. It's a poignant song. I think it works very well. And well done, Craig. Well done, Craig.
Yeah, yeah. And then I'm going to be laming that. That's going to be my album as well.
Adam, we're not on that yet.
I know, but that's my album. It's just to get it out the way.
What are we going to talk about?
I'm
in
going
the
for a wee.
On that note, wee.
So who should we? Who gets the Golden Lee then?
Should we give it to the weekend, seeing as we all kind of agreed it was
so we're not giving it to Craig.
Not a bad song.
Fuck Craig. He took us to the court.
Hang on, if we give it to Craig, we actually have to send him a Golden Lee.
Yeah,
so.
That's true. Yeah, okay, the weekend then.
Absolutely. So despite none of us picking it as our favourite song, it wins favourite song of the year.
The asterisk wins.
The asterisk wins, it comes through. Who'd
the underdog.
What? And if that's not 2020 in a nutshell, then I don't know what is.
Yeah.
So, moving on to album of the year, I won't lie, this is going to be something you wouldn't expect from myself, but I'm going for a rap album, so I'm going for album of the year is Run the Jewels, RTJ4.
Nice.
Haven't heard it.
Nope.
And it's a lot of content around Black Lives Matter and the kind of state of the world. So, incredibly, a lot of it was written before the George Floyd stuff. But I've actually got an excerpt to read you out here. So, every day on the evening news, they feed you your fear for free. And you so numb, you watch the cops choke out a man like me. Till my voice goes from shriek to a whisper, I can't breathe. And you sit there in your house on the couch and watch it on TV. The most you give is a Twitter rant and call it a tragedy. But truly the travesty, you're being robbed of all your empathy. And the fact that he wrote that before George Floyd the outcome of that one, it's crazy that's kind of,
yeah.
It's so prophetic and sadly gives a kind of the state of the world in 2020.
You think he would have learned from what happened to Eric Gardner, like that, you know, you just, weird things happen when you choke people, you know what I mean? Like, you don't know what's going on and you shouldn't,
it's crazy.
Especially for 9 fucking minutes. That's just insane.
Yeah. And it's mental in 2020. These are things that we're actually talking about.
Yeah,
and still have to discuss. But you know, it's really good album, kind of really deep. But it's stuff like that you just go into it.
Yeah,
but it's really kind of cuts in. And there's quite a good few cameos in there, including Zach De La Rocha from Rage Against the Machine. So you know, there's a lot of kind of political and like kind of, you know, really kind of heated racial debate on it. Really, so. For me, we talked about it in the debate. Me and Adam did. Polly was having a shit.
I wasn't.
The zeitgeist of the time and kind of. I think you know, it, a lot of people have struggled to kind of capture the feeling with lockdown. But I think that that kind of album really kind of sits for 2020 as the kind of obvious feature, saying this is still happening in this year, which is just baffling.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wholeheartedly agree. I mean, I was a little bit disappointed about trying to bring the mood down that you didn't rap that and you just said it. I was going to go...
in the back could never do it justice and would never try and do it justice.
But, well, we have Dr. Dreidel over here. I thought you would have done it.
Dr. Dreidel.
Dr. Dreidel.
But, yeah, I went for... My asterisk was an artist who... It was actually around the Black Lives Matter movement. When the Mercury Awards came out, it was like Best British Artist, and she didn't get nominated. Her album didn't get nominated. Jordan actually put me onto this album, and there was a bit of controversy over it because I think she grew up in England, but she was born in Japan, and it was an artist called Rina I'm going to say her name wrong, Rina Sawayama. With her album
this,
called
actually.
Sawayama. And it's really good. It's really good. I remember Jordan sent me it early on in the year. And it's a bit of a mixture of like 90s pop. Like, it reminds me a bit of like, I don't know. It's really, honestly, I'd go back and listen to it. It's really good. It's a bit of a mixture like of different like genres or album on the album. But it's really good. And I'm not really into like pop music that much. I know I voted for fucking The Weeknd and Miley Cyrus and the previous one, but usually I'll never even toy with the idea of listening to that kind of thing, and I really enjoyed that. But what I went for is The Archer by Alexandra Saviour.
Not heard that.
So her first album, Alex Turner, co-wrote and he produced it. And ooh, she got really annoyed when she was touring it, because whenever they got interviewed, they just wanted to ask her about Alex Turner all the time.
Yeah,
I bet.
And like, I think she had a bit of a bad time over it, so it came for a second album, which it's different from the first one, because I loved the first album. But I really enjoyed it because it was more hair. And I was going to go see her in the summer. I was going to go down to Bristol and watch her with Jordan. And that obviously got cancelled.
Shame, isn't
it? So I went for hair. But at the same time, I was also going to put Craig down. Even though it's not an LP, it's an EP.
Yeah.
It is basically an album. So
it's about what pretty much an album is these days for like
I will put. Although I enjoyed The Archer a lot and I did enjoy Rina Sawayama's album a lot, I will also say Craig.
Yeah. So we're all in agreement. Craig.
We now have to send him a golden link.
No.
You love him. We love him. Craig.
Brilliant.
The golden Lee is on its way from imminently.
Nice.
So the another segment of best TV show. So this is any kind of entertainment, whether it be on Netflix, Amazon Prime, Apple TV, Rakuken, Dave, Sky Atlantic, 4 or 4, iPlayer, etc. There's another suggestion there. We'll come back to that in a bit. But for me, the winner overall was the first one, Netflix. Tiger King wins that one, hands down for me.
It was pretty good.
Batshit crazy.
Amazing. It summed up our year, really, didn't it? Like, it was the start of lockdown. I mean, that's
the start of Power Hour.
That's what I put down.
Yeah, exactly. It was one of the first episodes, wasn't it?
I think our most viewed Power Hour episode is the tag where we talk about tagging. Yeah. So,
and with good reason.
So, you know what? I will be putting that in the tags for this one. Hopefully, we get a few more.
Yeah, riding the
we're back.
Carol Baskin wave.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Chris, do you want to go next?
So, I mean, I did write Tiger King, but I'd like to throw another suggestion out for Riley Reid Blacked Anal Compilation.
Oh, no. Damn, that was my one.
Surely that was that's more of a film.
Yeah, maybe.
No, well, I watched it in parts, so I class it as a series.
A limited series.
I've got to say that 1 to 3 were the best. It was the greatest camera angles I've ever seen on a compilation.
Nice.
Great cinematography.
Lovely. Yeah, I've got a few asterisks. For a documentary series, I've got The Last Dance, the Michael Jordan doc. I thought that was amazing.
Oh, yeah.
That was really good. Great watch. That, like, I'd probably look forward to that during lockdown. Like, every Monday it came out. And I was like, it was nice to just have two hours. Yeah, exactly. So that's one asterisk. The other one is The Boys. I don't know if you've seen The Boys.
It's on my list. Yeah, that's really
good.
Yeah,
it's great. Like, it's so, like, gory and dark, but, like, funny as well. It's a great show. Also, The Mandalorian.
I thought you were going to mention The Mandalorian.
Mandalorian, like, second series of Mandalorian was great.
What about the woman DeLorean?
And the children DeLorean, too.
And the alien DeLorean.
The what DeLoreans?
The alien DeLoreans.
All right. I don't know if you guys, I won't spoil anything, but, like,
The other asterisk for me, I'm not sure if you watched it, was Normal People.
I watched a bit of it. Yeah, I did like it, but I think it was more Lou watching it, and I was watching it as well, and then I'd, like, sort of missed a few episodes and just never came back to it. It was
also
series,
another
though.
One that I've only just remembered, which I think we all liked, was the latest series of Dark Side of the Ring.
Yeah, that was really good.
They've done a great job. Yeah.
Love the blurry fights in the background.
Yeah, they do it really well. It's filmed really well, isn't it? And I know there's going to be another series as well now, so
I think I really liked Jim Cornette's promo on what's his name? The writer, blanking on his name now.
Russo,
yeah. He got a good promo on Russo.
They hate each other.
Yeah. They hate each other proper, yeah.
But yeah, my...
I mean...
I'll give you my actual award. I don't know if you've seen it, The Queen's Gambit. Really enjoyed that.
No.
Yeah. It was the chess one.
Yeah, it's just about a girl who's like a chess prodigy. And it was really good. Like 8 episodes. And like I think I watched it in like 2 days. And it's just... really, really good too, and it wasn't like.
Do you want a fucking golden lead to you for watching it in 2 days?
Yeah.
Stop bragging, lads.
Go on, kiss it then. You may can send it to me.
Yeah, the in a bit of Chris zone here. I started watching Mr. Robot after it finished. So that finished just the very, very end of December 2019. So I watched that. That was really good. So that's obviously ineligible for an award here, Chris.
Yeah, but
I take it back. My favourite TV show was Seinfeld.
Mine is The Sopranos.
But no, that was very good watching, though. That, I highly recommend the Mr. Robot to anyone.
Yeah, Mr. Robot's great.
Fantastically, again, the cinematography and director of that was is fantastic.
But guys,
ineligible this year.
Yeah, so from watching the Queen's Gambit, I've started learning how to play chess. I've been playing online. I beat a guy from India today and a guy from Brazil.
Nice.
Shout out to the Brazil community.
The what community?
The what community?
The Brazil community.
All right.
All right.
Yeah, so I'm gonna say if General Knowledge ever ends up being our Power Hour champion, I want to challenge him for that belt with a game of chess.
A radio chess match?
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh. Because so we can start happens, it in one Power Hour and he can finish in a subsequent Power
I don't know
power
how
hour.
I'm going to beat him because he does know everything, so he probably knows all the moves. But I'm going to challenge
gonna
him.
It's going to constantly go to stalemate.
Yeah. Yeah. He's just going to keep stalemating me.
But yeah. Well, you know, oh, I think in 2021, I would like to see that the Power Hour Championship is won over, like a little bit like the BTE Championship. If it's on the Power Hour, I would like it to be
a unique
match. It doesn't have to be a wrestling match.
Yeah.
If we can do all the
game of tiddlywinks.
I will challenge anyone to a thumb war for that belt.
Yeah.
The rabbi would beat you in a thumb war. Have you seen the size of his thumb?
Yeah. Thumbs are huge.
Like claws.
Well,
I think we are giving the golden lead to Tiger King for
absolutely,
a TV
yeah.
show.
Absolutely.
It defines the year, I think.
Absolutely. Mm. So well done, Tiger King. You're gonna get your golden lead.
Well, who gets it
if it gets through prison?
Yeah, is it gonna go to Joe Exotic? Because that bitch
no,
Carol
yeah,
Baskin
not,
is
not
getting
that
no.
bitch Carol Baskin.
If she ever
no,
gets
that bitch Carol Baskin,
a clause on our award. She'd probably kill it.
Absolutely not. She can murder people for it. Yeah.
I've actually got another award, guys, that you didn't know about because I've only just thought about it.
Ooh.
But there's going to be a Golden Lee and it's going to be for the best people and you both win it.
Oh, thank
Yay.
You.
Yay.
Yes. I'll hang it proudly.
Chris, can we all share it with you?
Yeah, we'll
share
it.
Oh, shucks.
I'll cut ours in half.
I think finally, I've not really got much to contribute to this one, but best movie. Adam, I'm not sure if you want to.
Well, I was talking to Lou today
because
I was like, I what's come out this year besides Tenant, which I didn't see. Nothing's come out, and she reminded me that we at the beginning of the year because it was so long ago we went to see 1917, and that was just before lockdown started. And don't usually like war films.
Was that this year?
Yeah, apparently so. Yeah.
Oh wow.
It was early this year. So I don't usually like war films, but that was amazing. Like it was so well made, like all being in one shot and all that.
Yeah.
That was
Danny Bolt told me to watch that and Eddie Screw.
Yeah.
They mentioned that.
Wise words from the Tough Nuts.
Absolutely.
Not really much I can add
for films, really, to be honest with you.
Yeah, there's hardly anything to pick from.
I watched Soul the other day, which is
yeah,
great.
I watched Soul.
So,
Soul was good.
Soul gets my vote.
Yeah, Soul was a good film.
I watched, the only film I watched was half of Borat.
Yeah, I didn't finish Borat either.
Which half?
The second.
Watched the third part first, and the first part third.
So yeah, I have no contributions. So whatever you pick, I will say it was good.
Okay.
Well, actually, I did watch. Maybe if I edit in my opinion after this, I will watch part 1 to 6 of that Riley Reid compilation as one. Maybe that. Goes
okay,
fine.
Yeah, that might come in. Yeah.
Maybe that'll get my vote.
Yeah.
So TV confirmed on a future Power Hour, the winner of the best film.
Well, we kind of agreed on Soul, didn't we? So. I think let's give it to that.
Just because I haven't watched it.
No. Soul was the interim champion
okay.
to be...
Vacant?
To be...
No, Vacant wins it.
Vacant wins, but Soul is the interim champion until Chris watches the compilation.
Okay.
Well, maybe on Power Hour 21 or 22, we will have a best film match between a triple threat. Let's see who wins.
You can try and crack one off to the Soul, and we'll try and crack one off to
not to a kid's film.
When Ross was watching Soul, apparently there's a character who looks like me on it, and his girlfriend took a screenshot and was like, oh, Chris, it looks like you.
Which one?
And I there's like a pirate or something.
Oh, yeah.
There's actually a pirate who looks a bit like
yeah.
I commented back saying, why is it always weirdos I look like? His voice, she thought that I was offended.
He's voiced by Graham Norton as well.
why is that funny, Ross?
Well, just because, you know, you're a weirdo.
You green freak.
You have no soul.
Lovely.
But yeah, so anyway, I think we're agreeing soul as an interim champion.
Yeah.
And we'll confirm the status of that award later on.
Lovely.
Absolutely.
Shall we have some music then?
So, absolutely. Frio Walcott, Frio Pophetus, Frio James Moxley. This is Walcott by Vampire Weekend.
Nice.
By Vampire Weekend. So we're coming to the end of the last Power Hour of 2020.
Oh, no.
So, Chris, how do you think it went?
We missed a segment out, lad.
Well, no, we haven't. We can carry on.
Great.
We'll come back to our resolution, but we'll...
It went great. Just like I'll say in the next segment after the next bit, it went great. Oh, actually, this is the last song, isn't it?
Yeah, no, don't exactly. We have, like, power out, power out, power out, and all that?
No, we weren't going to do that. Fuck off, Adam. bit of context for everyone. We were originally all going to go on a night out around Christmas, and we were going to do a creative booking night where we plan everything,
yeah.
Which we're going to do after this. So we're all a bit drunk. So that's why I haven't got a clue what's going on. So yeah, to answer your question, Ross, yeah, it's gone great.
And rest assured that after the end of this booking meeting, it will say oil with a load of lines underneath it.
Oil good. Equals good.
So yeah, well, I think the segment you referred to, Chris, is New Year resolution. So all three of us were going to have one. So I'll go first. Mine is going to be to, pretty much as this podcast and radio show has shown so far, particularly because this one's going to be the record-breaking, like, probably two-hour podcast. more power.
Power
and
hours.
Certainly more hour. But I'm going to also try and lose a bit of lockdown timber. So maintain and get down to about 72 kilos. Make sure that I can compete in 205 live.
Nice. The high flyer.
I can't wait to see Ross versus Grand Metallic. Where is David?
Grand Metallic.
Grand Metallic. Grand Metallic, lad.
He's grand, him, that Grand Metallic.
It's your metal nan. Grand Metallic.
It's what's his name? It sounds like a heel character on Wheel of Dealers. Oh no, it's got some Grand Metallic.
We bought this car for £500. We spent £10,000 on it. We sold it for £10,000. Great deal.
Brilliant. Yeah, I think my New Year's resolution is to lose a bit of timber as well. Well, a lot of timber.
I need to go.
I need to go back from being the chunky monkey and become the hunky monkey again. So yeah, I've got a lot of work to do, but yeah. Hopefully.
Adam, I've seen you do it. I've seen you do that many a time.
Yeah, I've done it so many times that I'm not even worried.
I have every faith in that you're gonna do it, mate.
Yeah, it's getting in relationships with me. As soon as I get in a relationship, I just go, well, don't need to try anymore. Let's eat everything in sight.
We're back.
But like when I was single, I was really into
the shoot. And then you kill your girlfriends by lying on them. Oh, best get hunky again.
Yeah, we were laughing because when I used to go to jiu-jitsu, there was this lad, because I just used to hold people down in side control and just control them with like just being... Someone said you feel
monkey
like
strength.
you weigh more than the moon. So, and there was this like lad, and he was like, he couldn't get out. So he was like, can you just hold me in side control and I'll see if I can get out. So, and yeah, so I held him there for 10 minutes. Just the sheer
really,
weight,
yeah.
Just the sheer weight of the monkey.
Just fall asleep. are you
fucking snoring.
Breaking the fourth wall here, man.
I know.
Dude, they're right there.
They're watching us. Yeah, so my New Year's resolution, lose weight.
My New Year's resolution is to shag less beards.
Well, that's going to be quite difficult.
Well done, you've
Chris,
done it.
You need...
it's opposite day.
You need to be realistic here, Chris. I don't think you can shag beards.
My New Year's resolution is actually opposite to what you guys said. So I want to continue. Like, I put a stone on lockdown, mainly due to drinking. But I've always been really... I've always been really skinny and struggled. I felt, if I'm going to get deep here, boys, not had much confidence to the fact that I was like quite slim.
Mm.
So I want to try and gain weight, as much weight as I can.
Well, Chris, I've got good news for you. I've got loads of weight to give you.
You can take a bit from both of us.
I've heard if you suck someone off, you get their weight.
Yeah.
Adam, you can take that bullet.
So, that was directed at Adam, not you, Ross.
I'm completely fine with that one.
But, I mean, one of the main reasons is because I want to get a nice beach body. I don't think we've mentioned this, Ross, but the Power Hour's going on tour.
Oh, my God.
It's the last surprise of 2020. We're going to the exotic landscape on Gran Canaria.
We need to end the year with a nice reveal for the fans. They can't wait to hear us about us going on holiday. And we will be I'll be taking my laptop. I'll be taking my Blue Yeti. We're off to it, or my Blue Snowball. We're off to Gran Canaria to film many a Power Hour.
Lovely.
So I want to turn up. Now we're going to film multiple episodes.
I'll turn up via hologram.
you and Tupac and Bill Shankly.
Yeah, Bill Shankly's ghost just stands up and puts his hands up now and again.
How am I doing, boss?
Great, son.
Why am I a hologram?
It's us looking up to Howard Stern. How are we doing, boss? I want to turn up buff as a motherfucker, swole, and ready to just absolutely cock slap everyone who we see.
Within a 5 mile radius.
Start away, you, mister.
Lovely.
But yeah, that's the... that's it then. I think we've done Power Hour for 2020. Yeah. It's done.
What a year we've had. I mean, like, this, let's be honest, boys, this wouldn't have happened. We talked about this for years.
Yeah.
And if lockdown hadn't happened, we wouldn't have done...
Exactly,
We wouldn't have got Monday and Tuesday going. So, on a personal note, I'd just like to say thank you for...
Yeah, it's kept us.
To you two for... We've got to do this. And it's kind of kick-started it. Now that we're, like, when we are back in work and we're doing stuff, we'll still do it.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
And it's kind of it's made it happen, and it's got us through it. It's massively helped me.
Yeah,
through this year.
And absolutely. And more thanks to the dozens of fans we have who tune in and listen to us talking shit. And,
thanks,
and of course,
thanks, Jordan.
On Tuesday.
Thanks, Jordan.
Thanks, lads. Keep fighting the like fight, lads.
But yeah, I would like,
as always, like and subscribe, comments, etc.
Yeah, cheeky URL time, MNT Wrestling on Twitter, follow us. We'll make more of a push this year to like get the name out there. But for people who listen to us or if new people go back and listen to the stuff we've done now, thank you for listening.
Yeah, it's thanks to anyone who's listening.
And I'd like to raise a glass to you two boys, and thank you very much.
Yeah. Chin chin.
We enjoyed it.
Thanks,
lads. Everyone had a lovely holiday period and a better new year. And next year is going to be boss, so.
Absolutely. And we're going to play off with one final song for the year. Good karma, bad karma. We've got half a turkey crown left. Give me a naan bread and make a turkey karma. This is Culture Club with Karma Chameleon.
I'm a man. you come and go. Love it would be me if the colors were like my dream, red, gold, and green.